was 4 hours, a whole day of nothing but laying out in his presence. The truth of the matter is, if we spent as much time as we do watching the TV and on the telephone and on the internet and on Facebook and on Twitter and on everything else going on, you talking about some power, you talking about some anointing, you talking about God destroying us, we would not be able to contain the anointing in this room.
Amen.
So true.
Amen.
And we invested more time in his presence.
Yes,
if you look at the generals of, you know, of Christendom, the generals of faith, people that moved in great power, they moved in great power because they spent hours and days in the presence of God. They didn't do a day. There were days without eating, days with just drinking water, just enough to survive. But they're not talking about chicken and fish and vegetables. No, they were days without eating anything.
Right.
And what happened? It produced power in them that caused miracles to take place. It caused miracles to take place. When a person would wave their hand, tap the form, and she would wave her hand, she didn't have to say nothing to nobody, but the power of God would fall in the room over everybody that was in the room would go why? Because she understood what it was to consecrate herself and deny her flesh so she could get the power of God. We want miracles, but we won't go over to do anything to get the miracle. So we've got to learn how to prevail in prayer. And when you prevail, that means you gotta go against the grain. That means you're gonna come against a hard surface that's gonna cause coming your parameter to stop you and say, this is as far as you can go. But when you prevail, you push past the hard place.
Yeah.
Take your neighbor, say neighbor.
Neighbor.
You gotta move past the hard place.
Yeah.
And so the enemy is after your communication. If he can cut your communication off with God, he got you right where he wants you. He's after your fight. He does not like the fact that you got a fight in your spirit. If he can kill the fight, then he's got you. Because as long as you're fighting, that means that you're not just gonna allow anything to take place. You're just not gonna accept anything. But when you got a fight in you, you push past what your feelings say. You push past how your emotions are up and down with people, and you push past because you know there's greater in store for you. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I'm not gonna let the enemy have my fight in this season. And so in prayer, I went through the scriptures because I wanted to give you some people in the scripture who knew what it was to prevail in prayer. And who knew what it was to go beyond the obstacles and the turmoil and the troubles that they would face from day to day. Because after all, if we get around with a personal thing that is similar to where we're going, those sometimes it pushes us closer to where we need to go. And so there's a scripture that talks about in 1 Chronicles 4:10, it talks about a man by the name of Jabez. And the Bible says that Jabez was a man who asked God to bless him. And in 1 Chronicles 4:10, Jabez cried out to the God of Israel. He said, oh, that you would bless me and that you would enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me and keep me from harm so that I will be free from pain. And God granted his request. But the little scripture over in Isaiah chapter 38, verse 2 through 8, that talks about a man by the name of Hezekiah. And the Bible says that Hezekiah was on his deathbed when he cried out to God in prayer so that he would turn his face to the wall and pray. And the Bible says that Hezekiah turned his face to the Lord and said, Lord, oh Lord, would you remember me how I have walked before you faithfully and have wholehearted devotion and have done what is good in your eyes? And it said, and Hezekiah wept bitterly. And then the word of the Lord came to Isaiah and said, go and tell Hezekiah that this is what the Lord, the God of your father of David, says. And I will add 50 years to your life, and I will deliver you and the city from the hand of Ezekiah, and I will defend this city. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, you gotta learn how to prevail. for wisdom to be a good king. And the Lord, the Bible says that the speech pleased the Lord, that Solomon had asked him of this good thing. Now let's look a little deeper by putting ourselves into Solomon's shoes. Solomon asked God not for riches, not for money, not for fame, not for promotion, but he asked God for wisdom to lead the people the correct way. A lot of people ask God for notoriety, and God, I want the house and I want the car, but Solomon had every chance to do that, but he said, listen, above all of that, I just, God, I want you to give me wisdom and how to handle the situation. Talk to your neighbor, say, neighbor, you need to learn how to prevail in prayer. And then there's another scripture in verse 1, 10 through 11 that talks about a woman by the name of Hannah. We all know Hannah. The Bible said that Hannah was the one who went up and prayed to God because she was provoked into prayer. The Bible said, and she was in bitterness of soul. And she prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. And then she made a vow to the Lord. Oh, Lord of hosts, if you would indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but you would give your maidservant a male child and give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. Can your neighbor say, neighbor? You gotta learn how to prevail in prayer. And so today I come and talk to every Hannah in the room and tell you that don't worry about what's happening to you, because your Samuel is on the way. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, Samuel is on his way. Come on, look at somebody and say, neighbor, Samuel is on his way. So go ahead and dry your tears. I come to speak to every joint that's in the room and tell you it's all right to allow the prayers of the righteous to go up. But sometimes you gotta learn how to pray to God for yourself and ask him to bless you. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, it's time to prevail in prayer. I come to speak to every Hittite in the room and tell you that it does not matter what the doctor has said. It does not matter what your body might feel like. That if you learn how to prevail in prayer, that God can change the doctor's report. That God can call the blood test to come back a different way. That God can call the MRI to come out a different way. Tell your neighbor, say, Hezekiah, come on, keep on praying.
That's right, come on.
I'm going to talk to every baby in the room and tell them that just in case you messed up, and just in case you slipped up and did something the wrong way, that God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The newness of what it needs to do.
Yes.
When something is old and worn, it does not have the capability of holding something new, because when something is old and worn, there might be cracks in it, it might be things in it that you did not know that was there because you, it's so old, you're so used to using it, but when you pour something into it, it might seep out.
Yeah, that's right.
Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
He's doing a new thing.
Amen.
Tell him, can't you see it?
Can't
you see it? Come on, ask him, can't you see it?
Can't you see it?
Now ask him, can they feel it?
Can they
feel
it?
My
God. Ooh. Now what you ask him, can you sense it?
Can you sense it?
My.
He said, behold. Look around. Look at your surroundings. I know you look at a certain way. I know you got the flow of how it's gonna happen. You know who gonna get up and pray, you know who gonna shout, you know who gonna run around the sanctuary, you know who gonna do this. Look, he said, but look, I want you to look around now.
Yeah, yeah.
Cause there's something new that I gotta show you.
Yes, yes.
I know you know that Dad gonna get up and she gonna run around the sanctuary. And then this morning I heard confirmation of it. I said, okay, God, I said, all right.